The second con, the contribution of hug. Not talking about this kind of hug. We're talking about, as you know, a certain Johannes Leonhard hug. A little doubt goes a long way. And you probably recognize these other guys now, or maybe you don't. Do you recognize these guys yet? They're such beautiful people there. I mean, they just have such beautiful faces. That's Mabillon and Montfalcon. And when Chris was telling you about how the Counter-Reformation happened, let me give you a couple extras, okay? Number one, who set up the Council of Trent? Catholic Church, obviously, yes, but do you know who's behind it? The Jesuits, exactly. The Jesuits set up the Council of Trent. So one of the two forces of the Counter-Reformation were the Jesuit order. Actually, there's three. The second one, of course, was the pre-existing one, which was the Dominican order, which had and was running the Inquisition. Only with the Jesuit order, the Jesuits were silently running the Dominicans without it being known. So they had the, oh man, I have so much I could tell you. If we just talked about Jesuits, I got some books I could tell you about. But it's amazing what they were doing from behind the scenes. Now, along with them was another order, and that was the Order of Saint Benedict. The Order of Saint Benedict, or OSB. That's where that one group came called the Order of St. Maur. That's the Maurists. These two guys are from the Maurists. And that's where the other part of the Counter-Reformation came after the Council of Trent. I'll get you there in a little bit. So let me just start in here. Get out your Bibles to Luke 23, please. Look at verse 32. It says, "And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death." Verse 33, "And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots." How many sermons have been preached on Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? How many? I have no idea. How many times have you heard people saying that that's the ultimate act of forgiveness that Jesus could do? People said, "Well, that can't be true because he didn't forgive everybody from every age." I actually got a letter from that just a few months ago. And I said, that's not what he said. Them, they that crucified him, them, the very people doing the act itself, and the people who are approving, and the people who are jeering, and the people who are mocking, Father, forgive them. So from that point, I had a person tell me, well, God didn't listen to that. Jesus said the Son doesn't do anything but what he sees the Father doing. He doesn't say it unless it comes from the Father, right? So if he said, Father, forgive them, for the it's because it's what the Father wanted us to, because there's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, one God. We don't divide them up into little pieces. So when he said, Father, forgive them, that's what the Father wanted. It's what the Holy Ghost wanted. It's a unity. Tri-unity. We should try unity, actually. But tri-unity, which is shortened to Trinity, the Godhead. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That means when it comes to Judgment Day, and it is coming, every single person there, held for every other sin you can imagine, will not be held for that sin. Who did something similar to that later? Because he copied his Savior. Stephen. Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And he asked that of Jesus. Because he was looking at Jesus. Because God let him see him. And he wasn't sat down. He stood up for this. He stood up for his servant. Dude, made me cry. Wow, the Lord did that? Yeah, he did. And yet, according to Codex Vaticanus and a corrector of Sinaiticus, trusted based upon what? Paleography, that never happened. I want you to hear it in an emotional manner that it really starts to dig in. There is power in those words. And if those words are taken out, power is removed. A clear doctrine is removed. The reason that Stephen imitated his Savior is gone. That's not a small thing. See, I'm slowing down a little bit. I went a little fast the last one. I gave you guys so much. But we'll get faster probably in a minute because I'll get excited. Technically, the scholars wrote it this way. Okay? This is, if you look on the textual critical books, whatever, name it. I only picked part of it. I didn't want to take the whole list. But it says omit, and it has P75. Are you going to talk about that, Chris? Tomorrow? Tomorrow, tomorrow, we'll talk about it tomorrow. You're only a day away. Okay, so we got P75. That's one of the ones, and I'm glad he's going to talk about it because it's really vital. But can I go on? There's Sinaiticus. Now, this is such... I got to tell you some stories. Can I tell you some stories since it's nighttime? Okay. Tischendorf, or Tishy, if you want to call him that, or Dorf. Tischendorf didn't like that Alexandrinus had the letter A. That's the manuscript people have been talking about for a few centuries, okay? Alexandrinus. The guy named it because A for Alexandria. Well, or A for the first letter of the alphabet. We're just listing things off. The next one that they came across that they called Alexandrian was Vaticanus, so they gave it a B. Ephemeris Scriptus, C. Beza Canterbrigiensis, D. He didn't want an E. Tischendorf didn't want his Sinaiticus to be E, so he switched to Hebrew and went to Aleph, the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. That's why, and there's only one Hebrew letter, because he wanted his to be first. The three temptations of the minister are the gold, the girls, and the glory. He already had the girl, because it was the daughter of the Lutheran minister, and that was kind of had a prominence, even though he didn't spend any time with her except to make babies, and then he left for 5 years. But the second one, the gold, he wanted a little more money. He always wanted a little more money. He couldn't get a whole lot more. He kept on trying and never got it. And the third is the glory. He got so much of that. Philip Schaff, the guy who is part of the World Parliament of Religions and the editor of the American Standard Version, Philip Schaff said himself that there are some books written by Tischendorf where his accolades, that means all the things complimenting himself, are written in abbreviations in 10 whole lines. I have one with like 6. I think that's as far as mine. I haven't found the other ones, but I'm still looking. I want to find that because it's like, dude, so humble. He'll tell you about it. Anyway, so then he got B, Vaticanus. But that didn't, notice it didn't say Sinaiticus original. It says the second corrector, A. Second A. Okay. So what it means is somebody wrote it originally. Somebody else edited it and changed it. Then a third person changed that. There is a back and forth. And I can't wait to tell you guys the history that I'm finding out about Sinaiticus. But I don't think I'll have time to do it here because we only get an hour at a time. But then you got these other ones. Okay, so that's how they write it. They just call it, make it all technical. Well, these omit it, but because it's got these right here, this Sinaiticus or Aleph, and Vaticanus right here, and then it's got Beza, then see, that's a good reason that we should not have it in our Bibles. Okay? So, I don't want to go too much farther on that. I've got to keep going. Why do they trust those manuscripts? Because paleography. They believe that they can understand its date and its value simply by looking at it. The second one is textual criticism. They made up their own rules and changed them as they went along to justify their own beliefs. That's another story entirely. Paleography is the con that you can date a manuscript just by looking at it. I know how old that is. Really? Luke 22, can you go back a page? Starting at verse 41. Luke 22, 41. And he, that is Jesus, was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down, and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. 44. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. How many of you have heard sermons on that? You guys ever heard sermons on that? Preaching, talking about that, about Jesus? Seen movies and seen that in the scene? Well, is that important? He's in his moment of greatest need. I mean, since before the foundation of the world, he's the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. The plan was in motion from the beginning. He knew the day would come. And yet now he's at the point of realizing how serious this is and how much it's going to be as he in an earthly body like anyone else is going to bear everyone's sin. In that time on the cross, bear it for us. And he suffered being tempted just like anyone else. And as our perfect example, he prayed, and that's what happened to him. And an angel came and strengthened him. That's pretty powerful. I'm sure he said, 12 legions would have gladly come. One of them came. And that's awesome. And then that, the great drops of blood. Look at that. That is powerful. But according to modern textual studies, based upon paleography, that never happened. It's not people saying, well, it's in my footnote, therefore it's okay, isn't it? No. If it's not in your text, the publisher is telling you it never happened. One of the neat secrets I got to talk about in my book, Look What's Missing, is the simple fact that you've got to read the introduction to any Bible. Find out why it puts things in italics, why it put things into brackets, why it separates things with a line, and why it puts things into footnotes. Read the introductions and they'll tell you amazing things. What they really tell you is, we don't believe it belongs there, but we don't think you'll buy our Bible unless we have it there. That's what it really is saying. Okay? Nonetheless, when you find it in italics or in a bracketed section, like in the New American Standard, they'll put it in brackets, or double brackets, or they'll put a line between it and the other things. That means they're saying that never happened. That is not light, is it? That's serious. Technically, it's written like this. Look how bland that looks. Omit 22, 43 to 44. Oh, look, it's P75. Chris will have to talk about that tomorrow. And look, there's Aleph 2a again. And there's Alexandrinus. Oh, we got even Alexandrinus in on the game. And Vaticanus and a few others over here, including Family 13. It must be important. It has a number. So these manuscripts that they have judged to be better than others, never best, always looking for the better, never believing they'll find the best. Remember that. Textual critics are based on doubt, not faith. Textual criticism is based on doubt, not faith. They say that's science. No, it's not. Because that's, God never said he'll bless doubt, did he? Right? Did he say that? You know? If you read the word, that you're supposed to get doubt from it? Romans 10:13, doubt cometh by hearing, and hearing by the... No! It's faith. It's not even called the Christian doubt. It's called the Christian faith. That's what sets us apart from everyone else. Everyone else's works. Everyone else. Every other religion. And people try to make Christianity into that too. Christianity is based on faith. Why? Because we can't do that stuff. God had to do it for us. And the only way to know how serious what it was that God had to do is he had to do the work for us because we could not do it for ourselves. All right. Paleography is the con that you can date a manuscript just by looking at it. This is the theme of tonight's show. How do we date a manuscript? Do it with me. Provenance. That's it. Prove where it came from. 2, chain of custody. You got to prove that it's not been changed. 3, chemical testing. Dating and composition. What is it made up of? When did it come about? When did that chemical get formulated to make that ink or that color? And source documents. What is it copied from? So when does paleography actually matter? When you look at it and see what it is. And that's not until after we get the answers from the other 4 tests. If you answer it and it passes those things, or at least you're interested in it, those 4 things help you find out what you have in front of you. Then you use paleography to see what else you can learn. But it's only what else you can learn. Not everybody agrees with me, of course. Check out the Encyclopedia Britannica. What does the Encyclopedia Britannica have to do with it? Well, watch. There's the website right there. You go to britannica.com/topic/paleography/analysis-of-texts. That's right there online. You can look it up tonight. Let me make it a little clearer. Because of the immensely high prices of manuscripts, the question of forgery naturally arises. Well, good. At least they got that much. But it's safe to say that no modern forgery could survive for a moment. A convincing imitation of ancient script is virtually impossible. 24:27. While the papyrus parchment, or paper on which it would be written, could not stand up to modern scientific inspection, get an old piece of paper. Get an old animal skin. It's an old animal skin, so what does it have to do with what you wrote on it? Anything of recent vegetable or animal origin fluoresces brightly under ultraviolet light, to name but one test. What? William Henry Ireland died in 1835. The Shakespeare forger used fly leaves from 16th century books, but his handwriting and non-Shakespearean language gave him away. Well, it just means he wasn't a good forger. He didn't do his research enough. But what if he did do it right? What if his handwriting was a little better? Think about that right now. What if his handwriting were a little bit better? And what if he used Shakespearean language because he was a Shakespearean expert? All of a sudden, that invalidates what this guy just said, right? Because they would get away with it. It's always good to take things and turn them on their head and ask the simple question, well, what if we look at it this way? I love that. A modern would-be forger must either copy an existing work, which in the present state of art history and paleographical study would be immediately recognized, or be prepared to invent medieval subject matter. I could tell you about a guy in Orion, how a company bought up a forger detector. And it's current, right now. Because they've been trying to sell stuff. Is it Christie's? They try to sell stuff. And they have this 6-month policy that if you figure out that it's not what it's supposed to be, that they have to refund you. And they've been losing some money. because the forgers are getting better. And so this guy says you have to use certain things to detect it. If you want, tomorrow I'll bring up the article and show it to you. You have to find out its provenance. Sound familiar? You have to find out its chain of custody. I just found this the other day. It says, like, this is pretty cool. And then you have to find out its chemical composition. He's an expert at it. And then you have to find out if it's copied from something else, and if so, what? Sound familiar? And I came up with my list before I read the article anyway. The article's been out for a while, but I hadn't seen it. So the point is that truth is truth, and if you're looking for the truth, you're going to figure out some simple points. And I've been talking about it for a couple years, but he's an expert, and they're doing it now. He actually separates the stuff before they set up the auction, and they go through all the inventory, and he looks for what it is that people would possibly question or that he knows very well there could be a question about. There's a lot he just lets by. And then he goes, yeah, not that. And so he takes it off, and he goes down to the most minute inspection, actual chemical testing, not just shining lights on it, but actual chemical testing. And he's found some doozies, very similar to what I showed you earlier today. Based upon what you've seen now, just in the two sessions of what I've just shown you right on screen and talked about here, do you agree with Encyclopedia Britannica? If you agree with Encyclopedia Britannica, just raise your hand right up here because I want to see that hand. Because I got some swampland in Florida. Okay, nope. All right. Then you get the idea. This is a con. It's a big con, but it's big enough. Please catch this. Your kids go to school or homeschool, and you have looked this up, and you look this up, this article, in the Encyclopedia Britannica. By the way, starting in about the 1950s, Chris, when we were in Bible college, we started looking at the different editions. They started being written by Jesuits and other priests, and the history and the story started changing. The definitions started changing. The more influence they got in the scholarly world, the more they started redefining even the entries. So you could have one edition here and one edition here, and this one, the newer one, favors the Catholic Church. Isn't that amazing? Okay, so let me go on. I could go on forever. Jean de Mabillon. And I may have just... anybody speaks French, I apologize. He wanted to find out which Latin documents were real. That's actually a fair thing to do if you want to find out which ones are real. Now, he was 1632 to 1707. Isn't that beautiful guy? He looks like he had a haircut. Anyway, so he's a Benedictine Maurus. There's one of the two Benedictines I told you about, and the father of Latin paleography. So there you go. That's him. This is a quote from him. The historian, whatever be his subject, is as definitely bound as the chemist to proclaim certainties as certain, falsehoods as false, and uncertainties as dubious. That's actually an excellent quote, isn't it? He even adds the word chemist in there. I mean, that's pretty good. That's not what he necessarily did when it came to the scriptures, lowering the value of them, but nonetheless, those are the words, not of a modern scientist, but of the 17th century monk, Jean Mabillon, and they sum up his literary profession of faith. That's Margaret Deansley, written in 1920, the Lollard Bible and other medieval biblical versions. Interesting quote, huh? Now you got Bernard de Montfaucon. He analyzed Greek documents. There again, another Benedictine Maurists. So that Order of St. Maur, part of the Counter-Reformation, fighting history with history. That's another story, but no time here. Father of Greek paleography. According to Bible research by Michael D. Marlowe, you can still see it online. He did it from 2001 to 2012. He continually contributed to it. He's a majority text guy, but he has a lot of really good information in there. It's a great resource. It's thousands of pages. I know because I download it. Montfaucon, Paleographia Graeca, that's his word, Greek paleography, that's his big major book on the topic, confesses that he, what? He never saw a papyrus manuscript. But Mabillon and Montfaucon's writings cemented the belief that you can date a manuscript by looking at it. Now, if you know a lot of the other stuff, those four other levels that I've told you about, you can look at it and you can learn stuff about it. But if you don't, then you are subject to how good a forger the person was, or if it was fake, right? And they taught that the Bible should be treated as any other book. But what got us to the Vaticanus and Sinaiticus as the text we're supposed to believe? Here we go. Let's walk through this. This guy. Again, Johannes Leonhard Hug. 1765 to 1846. It's his tombstone because, well, he's not alive anymore and eternally not happy. On June 23rd, 1796, there was an armistice between Bonaparte and the Vatican. Did you know that Napoleon went through and conquered Rome? He conquered through Italy and he conquered Rome and got to the point when there was this agreement, an armistice, not a concordat, but it's a way of saying, okay, ceasefire, stop. Then we'll make an agreement with you. Here's the agreement. Quote, the Pope shall deliver to the French Republic 500 manuscripts at the choice of the same commissioners. I left out a whole lot because this would be, the letters would be this big and you wouldn't be able to read it. It's very long. There's a whole bunch of art and other things and artifacts that Napoleon wanted. And part of it, though, was 500 manuscripts that Napoleon or his people would choose. You with me? 1796. Samples of fine art and literature were to be placed in a national archives in Paris. This was a plan. I got this from Controlling the Archives, the Requisition, Removal, and Return of the Vatican Archives during the Age of Napoleon by Philip Kutcha, 2013. So I put the documentation very small there. So Pierre-Claude François Danon was under the custodian of the National Archives of Paris. I left out the story of the guy who was over him and he sent him and then he dies and this guy takes his place in 1804. I left all that part out. Danon was sent to Rome to help pick which things to take from Rome to Paris. Vaticanus left Rome. It was one of the 500 manuscripts chosen. It left Rome on July 24th, 1799. And in 1804, as I just said, Danon became the head guy at the Paris Archives, which was renamed the Archives of the Empire. Napoleon wanted to organize all the history and art of Europe, putting it into the Louvre, the art into the Louvre, and the manuscripts into the Bibliothèque Nationale, or the National Library. When Napoleon was defeated on March 31st, 1814, the Vatican archives were ordered to be returned to Rome. So now we've got between what year again? 1799 it left Rome, so sometime between 1799 and 1800, Vaticanus came into Paris. Again, 1814, the Vatican archives were ordered to be returned to Rome after somebody met his Waterloo. But while it was in Paris, in 1810, Johannes Leonhard Hug viewed the Vaticanus. Now, I've checked, and I went, well, maybe it was like 1809, and I checked even in his Latin text and the other translations and people talking about it. They all say 1810. So, in other words, he didn't spend a lot of time with Vaticanus. Do you get where I'm going here? You'll see in a minute. But just in 1810, Hug had the Vaticanus in front of him. Then he wrote a book, De Antiquitate Codicis Vaticani Commentatio, on the antiquity of Codex Vaticanus, a study. That's a very, very, very famous little pamphlet. Changed the world. Then, Granville Penn, the great-grandson of William Penn, wrote a book, Annotations to the Book of the New Covenant with an expository preface with which is reprinted J.L. Hug de Antiquitate Codicis Vaticani Commentatio. Okay? With me so far? In other words, he wrote a thing in English, a whole bunch of stuff, and then he took the same Latin treatise and dropped it in the back. And I asked for a year now, where's the English? German, anything. Nobody has translated that little document. And I don't read Latin. And Latin can be read so many different ways. I see people disagreeing even on how to read it. So I was like, dude, that's rude. Maybe because they don't want people to read it. The common folk. They just want you to trust me. Page 28, preface, number 22. I guess it's paragraph 22 or section 22. The principle of correcting criticism laid down by Johnson in the preceding extract, don't worry about that, is that which reason enjoins in the correction of all ancient writings. We're trying to correct ancient writings, okay? Find which ancient writing is correct. Whether profane or sacred. Remember, the Bible is viewed as any other book. Profane or sacred. Namely, to take the most ancient copy for the standard. To correct by authority wherever it can be found. In other words, the oldest is the best. You want to know where it came from? Here's Granville Penn. What year is that? 1837. Oldest is the best. You want to know how far that goes? 1837. And that was not an old view. That was a new view. In reflection on the writing in De Antiquitate by Hug. Sound familiar? Page 29, prefaced. Number 22, Schultz. Now, Schultz was a Roman Catholic, and he was a text scholar. And if you learn about Westcott and Hort, Westcott was actually like the head guy, and he had 12 disciples. And I'm still trying to find out all 12 names. That's how secret this seems to me. I'm still trying to figure it out. Do you know, Chris? The names of all 12 of his disciples? He had 12 disciples. I'm not kidding. And I know because it says they did, but it doesn't tell their names. Except Hort was one of them. And we know that. Hort was a young Greek scholar who in classical Greek was really, really good. And he just harangued him with this anti-Textus Receptus, anti-Reformation text. And so he believed before he even studied New Testament Greek that it was vile. Anyway, this is Schultz. Schultz actually was more conservative than all the other Greek paleographers and text critics. Nonetheless, Schultz says Vaticanus takes precedence of all manuscripts in point of venerable antiquity, for it was written in the 5th century. 5th century, of course, means the 400s, not the 300s. But that is a quote. And then Montfaucon, remember him, says Michaelis refers to the Codex Vaticanus. So Michaelis is talking about what Montfaucon is talking about in another section of this preface, refers Vaticanus to the 5th or 6th century. The 5th century is the 400s. The 6th century is the 500s. Blanchini is of the same opinion, for he has written over facsimile scriptus videtur ineunte seculo quinto, is written at the beginning of the 5th century. But Schultz says, another one, J.L. Hug, in his treatise on the antiquity of the Vatican manuscript, has proved that it was written before the middle of the 4th century. Do you see what they've done? If something was written in the 5th century, in the 400s, that's already after the fall of Rome. They're taking on the property. Roman Catholicism's going up. This is after Constantine. This is after. That's when they're dating. That was when they were dating the Alexandrinus. So when they say it's 5th century or 6th century, they're saying it's irrelevant. Okay? It's too late. But when they say it's 4th century, they're saying Constantine, 50 Bibles. Do you see the difference? What a difference a century makes. Okay. Again, section 22 from page 29 to 30, preface. The anonymous author of a review of this manuscript, cited by Bishop March, says, "It discovers the hand of a master and is not unworthy of the pen of Griesbach." That's Vaticanus. Vaticanus. Ugh. Pronounced most truly that the Codex Vaticanus is almost entirely free for those undeniable interpolations. Remember what he said? That a committee got together and decided to add a bunch of words? You think it's new when somebody with the NIV comes to you and says, well, how do you know the King James didn't just add words? That's the Westcott-Hort theory, with zero evidence and zero history. Well, right here, it's saying Vaticanus is almost entirely free from those undeniable interpolations and arbitrary corrections, which are very frequently found in the manuscripts. Vaticanus may be applied, therefore, as a means not only of confirming the genuine readings, but of detecting and correcting those that are spurious. Sounds like there's a plan to this, to change the Bible to match Vaticanus, doesn't it? Another part, preface number 25. The denomination of Alexandrian may perhaps be properly assigned to this manuscript, Vaticanus, but not the reason commonly alleged for that assignment, meaning that it was something like Origins, because there's some differences from Origins' writing in it. But the true critical reason for assigning this manuscript to Egypt, if not to Alexandria expressly, is found in its employing the known Egyptian orthography of some Greek words, as is shown in Hug's Commentatio. Do you see what they're saying? They're saying if you look at it, you'll see some Alexandrian turns of phrase and a couple letters here and there that match the Alexandrian way of putting letters, certain Greek words, like the mu before the phi, and don't worry about it. Anyway, it has to do with sticking letters in unusual places that the other Greeks didn't do, but the Alexandrians did. So obviously, if it's got those letters, it's got to be ancient and reliable, right? From Alexandria. Couldn't just be somebody imitating the style, could it? Number two, and then it says, about that period, early to mid-300s, the Codex Vaticanus was written in Egypt, and we possess it with all its authority of primitive transcriptions. In preface section 27, it's this long, and it's really confusing, so I translated it real simply for you. If Erasmus had come upon Vaticanus, they said, that would have become the received text of the Reformation. You know that's not true, right? Because he did know about Vaticanus, and he did reject it. The King James translators knew about Vaticanus. Have you seen in my video series or read the books? The King James translators themselves, it was when I was writing about the Apocrypha. I was checking the book by Brenton, Lancelot Brenton, his Septuagint, where he put it in the English, he put had the Greek, and he wrote an English translation of the Septuagint on the side. And unlike the rest of the book, and he's credited as the translator, Lancelot Brenton, okay? But when we come to the Apocrypha, in 10 of the books, I know I checked because I'm a wonk, in 10 of the books, the translation was exactly the same as the King James Apocrypha of 1611. It's the same translation. They copied. He copied word for word, except when the verse went and it was in a different order, he just switched the words. And then there's a couple other ones that he adapted. But 10 of the books. So that tells you two things. Because he said he was working from Vaticanus, and I checked it and compared it to Vaticanus, and it is. It goes together. Which means that the King James translators, not for Scripture, but for Apocrypha. Remember, Apocrypha means something that you open the lower drawer and you shove it in there and you close the drawer with your foot. That's what Apocrypha really means. If you talk to us, the scholars that talk about the history of that word, that's what Apocrypha means. So, is it Apocrypha? Yes, as a matter of fact, it is. In the Apocrypha, the King James translators used a text identical, basically, to the Vaticanus. So when they tell you the King James translators didn't have a manuscript as great as Vaticanus, well, they had it. It wasn't great. They only used it for what they didn't want. They established 7 basic objections to how bad the Apocrypha was. That's why every single page on the 1611 King James Bible at the Apocrypha says, instead of saying, Daniel and the lion's den and the three young children sing and all that stuff, it says Apocrypha, Apocrypha. It sounds like a pox upon thee, Apocrypha, Apocrypha, Apocrypha on the top of every single page. Till you get to the very end of 2 Maccabees, you turn that to the last page, and at the bottom it says, the end of Apocrypha. And the next one says, the New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because they knew the difference between Scripture and Apocrypha. I don't agree with this guy. Do you agree with this guy? Page 68 of the preface, Penn argues that the Vaticanus didn't originally contain accent marks, because it has accent marks, but saying, well, it didn't originally contain them, so there you go. And thus it makes it older by 3 or 4 centuries than the Beza Canterburgiensis, because paleography. Trust me, I'm a scholar. Again, quote, but since the learned bishop published his criticisms in 1793, the investigations of Hug in 1810 have enabled him to ascertain by ocular testimony, I'll get back to that, that the accents which appear in the Vatican manuscript have been added by a later hand. See his commentatio. Okay, wait a second. By ocular testimony. It means his eyeballs. He looked at it. I thought everybody looked at it. I mean, what do you do with the Vaticanus? You hold it behind your head and say, yeah, I'm looking at the Vatican. No, you got to look at it. His ocular testimony. I bear you my ocular testimony that everything I'm about to say is true. In other words, Hug looked at Vaticanus and was able to figure out instantly that the accent marks were added later. Brilliant. But with all that, as Chris mentioned, Codex Vaticanus was all alone. It needed a partner in crime. Enter Sinaiticus. That is Sinaiticus. Every page that is known at this moment that we know of. And if you want, you can watch my video series, which is, I have one called Something Funny About Sinaiticus, which is also like the world's oldest Bible, a fake. And then I also have Sinaiticus Timeline, where I go into detail about the 1800s, which I thought I was going to do here, but we're going a different direction, so we'll do that. Enter Sinaiticus. So here is the Sinaiticus, and now... It's not paleography that tells you all the things about the date of this, but you can learn some other things after you've settled the 4 basic questions. 1, provenance. 2, chain of custody, 3, chemical testing, and 4, source documents. And did I mention the one thing that I wanted to end with? Do you know how much chemical testing has been done on Codex Sinaiticus? Does everybody understand what that number is? None. The one testing that was set, 2015 April, was completely discontinued. I found the letter, and I'm going to show you the letter tomorrow. God bless you all.